Hello students, it's Dr. Yu. In this lecture, we're going to learn how to conduct job interviews. Previously, you learned how to be an interviewee. Now, you have to learn how to be the interviewer. Because it may be the case in your future jobs that you might actually have to interview people as well and not just be an interviewee. Because oftentimes companies just don't leave it to the HR or recruiter to do all the interviewing. At some point in the second round or third round of interviews, you might have to interview as a manager or as a colleague the new candidate to see if they would be a good fit for your department. So you really need to know how to interview on both sides. Plus, it's super insightful for when you actually do interview as a job candidate, because then you can see what both sides go through. So it's a really great exercise. And plus, if you're in my business and professional comm class, you will have to conduct an interview. So it all works out. It all works out. What we're going to learn first is how to open the interview. To open the interview, what you have to do first is you have to greet. So you're going to have some kind of greeting where you're going to say, hello, my name is so-and-so, tell people who you are. And this is where you're going to do some of the small talk as well. And then you'll have the orientation. So once you greet the person, do a little bit of small talk, because remember, you want to warm up the interviewee. Because one of the things is you want the interviewee to feel comfortable when you interview them. You want them to be at their best. One of the ideas of conducting interviews is you want the interviewee to be at their best. That doesn't mean that you have to make it easy on them, but what it just means is you want them to be warmed up, you want them to feel comfortable, so when you ask those questions, they're going to give you the best possible answer that they can give. And if their best possible answer still falls short of what you're looking for, fine, but at least you interview the candidate to the fullest extent. So once you've greeted them and warmed them up, then you're going to do an orientation. And the orientation, you're just going to tell them, so we're going to ask you a couple questions here. We're just going to, you know, feel free to ask us any questions at the end of the interview and let us know. And at the end, you can ask us questions and we'll go from there. Okay, so in the orientation, you're just telling them what's about to happen. We thought you were really interesting as a candidate. We saw your resume and we want to get to know you a little bit more as far as your aspirations and whether you think you'd be a good fit for this company, and walk through the steps with them. And then you want to motivate them. And when you motivate somebody in an interview, what you're trying to do is just tell them it's okay to relax. It's okay, you're going to be awesome, you're going to be great. We're looking forward to getting to meet you and to know you. The other contexts where these interviews happen, and so this might seem a little off for like a job interview. So wait, you do an orientation and a motivation for a job interview? Yes, and you also use this type of interviewing and everything I'm teaching here, not just for job interviews, but when you're doing exit interviews as well. So when you decide to leave a job, a good employer will want to know in depth why you left and what your satisfaction was and how they can improve. So an employer will conduct an exit interview, and then it'll be sort of like this, except now you're leaving the company. And then in that case, if you're conducting the exit interview, you're going to want to do this as well. So greet them. Make them feel good, talk to them, get to know them a little bit, ask them how the drive was, orient them, tell them what's about to happen. We're gonna ask you, we thought you were interesting, we'd like to ask you a couple of questions. You can ask those questions at the end. We plan on interviewing other candidates and there will be more rounds, but you can ask us anything else about the process at the end. And then motivate them, say something along the lines of, but feel free to answer the questions as best you can. And if you need time to think, no worries. We want to see you at your best. All right, you ready? Okay. When you do the greeting, you want to make sure that you have a good handshake. So once again, practice the good handshake. You can talk about shared interests as well. If you notice that the person's an alum from Austin Community College and you are too, you can bring that up and say, oh, I saw you graduate from Austin Community College. Okay, what year? You know, that kind of thing. And then you can talk about professional things as well, you know, relating to what's going on in the industry or what's going on in the stock market or anything that's related to your field. When you orient them, explain the reason for the interview. Tell them what you might use the information for. So you would probably use this more for information-seeking interviews, like with focus groups or when you're doing some kind of research. So you wouldn't necessarily have to say information use in a job interview, but then you might also establish ground rules as well. So in the job interview orientation, what you might say is you can ask us questions at the end. So that way you don't have the interviewee interjecting questions and throwing you off your game. But if you want the interviewee to ask questions throughout the interview instead of at the end, let them know that. So that's what the ground rules are for. The ground rules basically tell the interviewee, here's how we want you to behave, or here's how we want this to go. And, you know, if you have any issues, let us know. And then sometimes you'll estimate the length too. Like you can say, we only intend this interview to be about 30 minutes. We have a 30 minute time slot saved for you. So let's try to be done by 4 o'clock. That's a good thing to do for the interviewee, because then the interviewee knows when questions come at the end, if you decide to do it that way, that if it's 4:55 and the interview is supposed to run from 4:30 to 5, that there's only 5 minutes left in the interview. So it's a good thing as an interviewer to give your interviewee as much information as possible so they know what to expect, they know the length, they know what the rules are, so they're not in these awkward situations. And then they leave saying, I wish I would have been able to say this, but I didn't know when or what the context was. Because once again, you want your interviewee at their best. And then as far as motivation goes, you want to encourage the interviewee. You want them to feel like that they can do this, because once again, you want them at their best. You can emphasize that it's important to do your best and really emphasize that. And that's pretty much it. Now, let's talk about types of questions. Now, a lot of this will run parallel to what you learned in interviewing as a job interviewee, but some of these, there's some additional things that we can add to this. So when you're the interviewer, you have two types of questions. You have primary questions and secondary questions. And then within primary questions, there are two types. You have open primary questions and closed primary questions. An open primary question is a question that is not answered with a simple yes or no or dichotomous set of options. An open question would be, how do you feel about working in an open office? So an open office environment. A closed-ended primary question would be, have you worked in an open office environment? The difference is the open question doesn't allow you to answer with a simple dichotomy of like yes or no, left or right, up or down, that kind of thing. A closed-ended question does. Have you worked? It's a yes or no question. It's not asking how or why or tell us about. It's very closed-ended. Describe your work experience or describe your experience working with Microsoft Excel. So here it's open-ended. I can't answer with a yes. Yes. Okay, you can't do that. But how many years have you worked with Microsoft Excel? That's a closed-ended question because you can only really answer with a number. 25, 3, 1. Now you can try to explain the number. Well, I've worked with Excel here and I've worked with Excel there. But technically, all you're expecting is just a number. If they said, I've been working with Excel for 4 years, that's all you need. Now, how do you develop primary questions? There are three main sources for primary questions. First, the resume. One of the big things that you have to be able to do when you're the interviewer is read critically between the lines. Because one thing that you learned in resume writing earlier in the lecture series is that there's a lot of ways to write things to sound better than what they are. And so your job is to take everything you learn from resume writing and now apply it critically to what you're reading and figure out, okay, so when they said they spearheaded the launch of this project, what exactly does spearheading the launch mean? Did you come up with the idea? What, did somebody give it to you and then you just executed it more or less? So what does that mean? And that's a good question to ask. Ask about transitions and gaps in work history. That's probably one of the biggest things that you have to look for when you're interviewing people, is look for the transitions. Why did you leave your previous company to come to the current one that you're at? They might tell you that they were fired. They might tell you that they got bored. They might tell you, and this is a good time to figure out, how do they perceive their work history? And then if they have gaps, ask them about the gaps. So I noticed you don't have any work history between 2016 and 2017. What were you doing then? You know, were you, and let them explain. Oh, I was on a mission trip, or I was helping a sick family member, something like that. Okay, cool. At least now you know that gap. Clarify their duty description. So go on their resume and see what they write down for their descriptions. Clarify some of those things. Ask them to explain, what does it mean when you said this, this, and this? Sometimes people hire resume writers. Heck, people hired me to write the resumes for them. A good way to smell those people out is ask them to explain things that they wrote. So if you see like a really nice looking resume, it looks like it was professionally done, I would be asking very specific questions about duties and things that were written, and then see if they really stand to muster. Okay. Also, measure their confidence on their skills claim. So on their skills section, ask them, okay, if we gave you a project that involved doing X, Y, and Z, would you know how to do that on Excel? and see their nonverbals. A lot of them will still say yes because they don't want to sound bad. But if they say yes, look at how they say yes. Do they look confident when they say it? Do they kind of look down? Do they, oh, yeah, I think I can do it. I would put a circle on that one, because they didn't sound too confident. So a lot of times you're not just listening to words, you're listening to nonverbals very deeply. So measure that. So here's a resume, for example, that you can look at. What might be some questions that you can come up with just off the resume alone? So think about it. Go ahead and pause the video if you'd like. So all kinds of questions you can ask. You can ask about the transitions between each of the jobs. So why did you leave Vice President Residence Hall Association to become an orientation leader? That looks like a little bit of a demotion. What exactly happened there? Okay, and they might have a reason for why that happened. Maybe it closed. You can say oversaw election process. Okay, so what did that involve? Okay, and then you can ask all kinds of things. So developed inclusive community among 40 residents and facilitate positive interactions among all. How did you do that exactly? And what kind of residents did you work with? Okay, so these are all things. Implement and enforce all university and on-campus housing policies. Okay, how did you enforce them? So asking these very specific questions that are written on their resume and seeing how they unpack them is a great way to see what if they really understand what they wrote and really getting to the meat of what they wrote. The second source of primary questions are the applicant, him or herself. So when you're talking to an applicant, your applicant becomes a source of all kinds of questions. For example, you can ask biographical questions. So tell us about yourself, or what draws you to this position, or what are your greatest passions? You can ask strengths questions. So why should we hire you? Ask the value questions. What are your three greatest strengths? Your limitation questions or weakness questions. What are your weaknesses? What's something that you're not good at? What's something that you think you can improve about your programming abilities? Something like that. Any of those would be applicant primary questions. Or their personality. How well do you take feedback? You know, how do you feel about working in a fast-paced environment? Might be another question. Another source is the job posting. The job posting should be the major source where you get a lot of your questions. So you should get a lot of questions from the job posting and a lot of questions from the resume. And then a few questions about the candidate. So the job posting or the company should also be a source where you come up with questions. Number one, you should definitely ask about requirements. So if your job posting has specific requirements, you need to make sure your candidate meets those requirements. So if your requirement is you have to be able to run a CNC machine, and this is the first interview with the candidate, you better ask, can you run a CNC machine? And then ask specifics. How long have you been able to run one? What are some specific things that you've ran on it? And so forth. Responsibilities. Have you ever presented to C-suite executives? So if the job's responsibility is to sell to C-suite executives, have you done that before? So ask a behavioral question or a situational question. Reflect on a time when you had to sell something to a C-suite executives. What was the product and how did you do it? So a lot of interviewers really like behavioral questions and hypothetical questions. So definitely think about how can I put this in a behavioral format? And then company culture. So that kind of goes with biographical, but it can also go here too. Do you thrive in fast-paced environments? How do you feel about working in a remote setting? Our company is 80% remote. How do you feel about not working in a office on a regular basis? And then customers. So you have to think not just what the company, but what the duties are, but you got to think about the company overall. If your company works with a specific customer base, you need to ask questions, do they care about this base or not? So have you worked with blind children? If your nonprofit or your company markets to blind children, they're gonna want, like, don't you want everybody there who works there to care about blind children and not just be mercenaries who are just there for the money? So these are questions that you wanna ask. What does the company produce? Or what kind of population does the company work with? Do they care about the population? Do they care about the product or the service that's going to that population? These are things that you really wanna know. Because this is what's going to help you separate the mercenaries from the patriots, okay? The people who really believe in the cause, the patriots and the mercenaries, the people who are just there for the money or for the career advancement. You got to separate the two. That's how you separate the two. Now, there are different formats of primary questions. So remember, we've talked about this in the interviewing lecture. There's behavioral questions. Tell us about a time when you successfully led a project. So these are questions about your past. Then you have abstract questions. Remember, these are questions about your present. How do you ensure success in projects that you lead? And then hypothetical questions. These are questions about your future or hypothetical situations. So if we were to put you in charge of a project, how would you ensure that it is successful? So behavioral, abstract, and hypothetical. So you find things on the resume, you find things in the job posting, you find things about the candidate, and then you craft the questions in behavioral, abstract, and hypothetical formats. And you try to mix it up too. You try not to do all behavioral, try not to go all abstract. You try to mix it up with a little bit of everything. So here's an activity. Go ahead and create three primary questions off the job description below. Make one behavioral, one abstract, and one hypothetical. So here's the job, retail sales rep, and here's the responsibilities, you know, and then these are the responsibilities. So see if you can make three questions, one behavioral, one abstract, and one hypothetical off this posting. Okay, if you need more time, pause the video. But there's definitely all kinds of questions you can ask. There's no one set of questions that I was particularly thinking of, but just as long as you hit the three formats, that's the critical thing. So a behavioral question might be, tell us about a time when you had to sell a new product to a customer who had no background knowledge. How'd you do it? Okay, that would be behavioral. Abstract, you could say something like, what is a good greeting to you? Okay, that's interesting. Greet all customers daily. What's a good greeting to you? And then hypothetical. If we were to put you in charge of a team of leaders, how would you ensure that everyone follows all standard operating procedures? Okay, or a team of customer experience specialists. So if we were to put you in charge of a team of customer service specialists, how would you ensure that all SOPs were followed? That's a hypothetical. All kinds of questions you can come up with, but it's all based on the job posting. Now, you also have secondary questions. So here are secondary questions. Secondary questions are follow-up questions. So think of them just as follow-ups. So you ask your primary question and then you follow up with the secondary question. One thing you can do is you can repeat. So let's say you ask people, you know, you ask somebody, how do you feel about working nights and weekends? And they kind of give you a long answer. Just repeat what they said. So are you comfortable working nights and weekends? So just repeat your question and then see if they answer it the second time. You can also elaborate. Let's say somebody gives a really vague answer. You can ask them to elaborate on something specific that they mentioned. So if you're talking about event planning and somebody says, oh, I planned an event a long time ago that ended up getting 3,000 people and it was a really great event. Can you say more about the event you mentioned? So that's a secondary question off them saying the event. You can ask for clarification. If they say something that's really vague that can be interpreted in multiple ways, for example, if they say, I like working with kids, do you mean infants or toddlers? Because kids is a broad category. That's a clarification question. Paraphrasing. If somebody gives a long-winded answer, you have two options. You can repeat the question again, or you can paraphrase it into what you think is the answer and let them confirm or deny if that's correct. With silence, you can also just use silence too. If you want somebody to talk more and you just, they're not really saying anything, just stare and nod. And because the interviewee is gonna be less likely to be comfortable than you are, they're gonna fill the air with more information. So just do the stare and nod and they'll keep talking. You can also use continuers. I see. Especially when you're on the phone, if you're doing phone interviews and you have to interview somebody that way, I highly recommend using more continuers just so the interviewee can feel a little more comfortable. Because the worst is when they're a total robot and then you don't hear anything on the other end of the phone and then you think that you dropped the call And then you have to like ask questions, and yeah, it's less fun to do phone interviews in a high structured format. And then you have clearinghouse questions. A clearinghouse question is kind of the anything else you want to tell me. Did I miss anything? Was there anything else you wanted to say? Because here's the thing, sometimes your questions will guide the interviewee a particular direction, but the interviewee may want to say something else, but because your questions don't specifically call for them to say it, they never say it. So what you have to do is create a moment where if there's something on their mind that they just haven't been able to say yet because your questions haven't directed them there, a clearinghouse question is a perfect way to make sure that everything they wanted to say was said. And if they don't have anything to say, okay, great, you just move on. They'll say, no, I think that was everything. Great. Now, the next part of this lecture is about legal and illegal questions. So let me just say that this is for educational purposes only and is not meant to be taken as personal legal advice. Any type of information that you receive regarding employment discrimination should not lead to any type of action towards an employer or any interested parties without first consulting a licensed attorney. Dr. Yu, which is me, is not and does not claim to be a licensed attorney. So we're going to talk about some questions that you need to avoid asking in an interview because of laws. And I'm not a lawyer by any means, but these are just things generally that I've seen with looking at HR websites and such. So here are some things that you got to be careful about when you're interviewing people. And these are good things to know as well as an interviewee, because then I'll explain some options to you. So generally, illegal questions are associated with certain topics. Now, things are going to get complicated really fast, because here's what's going to happen. I'm going to show you illegal questions regarding a topic, but then later I'm going to show you legal questions on that same topic. So there's an illegal way to ask something, but there's also a legal way to ask it. So I'm going to show you both ways so you're aware. The first topic is race. It's generally illegal to ask about race. For example, what is your race? You cannot ask that in an interview, ever. So just don't ask it. What is your race? Even if it's obvious and you think you're confirming it or something, nope, cannot ask. Don't even try to think it's obvious. Age. You cannot ask somebody in an interview, how old are you? Now, once again, there's some complexity to this and I'll explain it later, but you cannot ask somebody, oh, so by the way, how old are you? Okay, you can't do that. Can't do that. Disability. So you cannot ask somebody, do you have any disabilities? Just straight up cannot ask people, what are your disabilities? Or what do you have any? What are they? Okay, you can't do that. Next, religion. You cannot ask somebody, what religion do you practice? That is not a legal question, and so you should not ask it. Now, we will talk about exceptions to this, because we will talk about bona fide qualifications, which is another thing we'll talk about in a second. Then you have more marital status. You cannot ask somebody if they're single or married. Okay, so marital status, there is such thing as marital discrimination. There is also such thing as parental discrimination. You cannot ask about parental status. You cannot ask, do you have children? Now, interviewees tend to volunteer this information. And we'll talk about, well, what happens when an interviewee volunteers this information? And I see it all the time in mock interviews with my students. Somebody will say, oh yeah, my kid, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, you probably don't want to reveal your parental status, okay? Because there is parental discrimination. And then sexual orientation. So you cannot ask somebody if they're gay, straight, lesbian, anything like that. You have to, that has to be completely irrelevant to your interview schedule. And then military status. Now there's things that you can ask and things that you can't ask, but you can't ask, have you been deployed? Because that's where you get into veteran discrimination. So, because we already know that veterans do have a hard time because of this sort of discrimination. So technically you're not supposed to ask, have you been deployed anywhere? Implication being, do you have PTSD? That kind of stuff, which goes back to disability and such. So cannot ask that. Now, you also cannot ask things about citizenship. Are you a US citizen? You cannot ask that question in an interview, but I will show you what you can ask later. And then criminal history. You cannot ask, have you ever been arrested? Because remember, just because you've been arrested doesn't mean you're guilty of anything. You have to remember that. In the United States Constitution, you are presumed innocent until proven guilty. Just because you've been arrested doesn't mean that you're guilty. You're not guilty until a jury or a judge finds you guilty in a court of law. So you cannot ask people, have you been arrested? Now, here are the legal versions of those questions. So I just said you cannot ask about these things, But employers have legal ways of asking related things. So let me show. The first thing is, so I'm not like a labor lawyer, but there basically are such things as bona fide qualifications. The idea is this: if an employer is hiring for a particular job that has certain requirements that require them to ask the protected questions, then they may have an exception. There may be exceptions there. Okay. Now, I can't go deeper than that in the law, like, well, how do they do that and all that stuff, but there, that is a thing. So examples, there's a famous case with Hooters, the guy who sued Hooters because he thought he was being discriminated against because he wanted to be a waitress, but Hooters wouldn't let him. And the Supreme Court sided with Hooters. Look, being female is part of the bona fide qualifications of the Hooters brand. So therefore they're allowed to not hire men as waitresses. Clergy. So if you're at a church and you're hiring clergy people, then yes, you can definitely ask what their religion is, because that's a bona fide qualification to being a clergy person, is that you are religious, okay? Bus drivers, so they can ask what your age is, and because you have to be a certain age to drive children, and so forth. So you have to keep those in mind when you're thinking about questions. And you have to get legal clearance before you do anything with bona fide qualifications. Talk to your lawyer, talk to your attorney, and then make decisions from there. Now, if they're asking about age, okay, so they can't ask you how old you are, but they can ask you, are you over the required age for operating this kind of machinery? So some machinery, like operating a forklift, requires you to be, I think it depends on the state, but I think it's like 18 or 16, one or the other. And so you have to be over the age to operate the machinery. So they can ask you, are you over that age? But they just can't ask you your birthday. For disabilities, they can't ask you what your disability is, but they can ask you, can you perform the specific duties of this position? So they can ask about, are you able to do all the things that are on this list? And as long as you say yes, you're okay. And then religion. They can't ask you what your religion is, but they could ask you, can you work on Saturdays? Or can you work on Sundays? And so there, depending on what your religion is, you still have to answer that. Well, no, I can't work on Sundays. Or yes, I can work on Saturdays, and so forth. Parental status. So they can't ask you, do you have children? But they can ask you, can you work overtime? That's perfectly legal. So if you have to pick up kids at daycare at 5 o'clock every day, you know, Monday through Friday, you know, can you work overtime? Okay, so that's where you have to decide. And then citizenship. They can't ask you, are a U.S. citizen? But they can ask you, do you have the legal right to remain permanently in the United States? Because you don't have to be a citizen to be in the United States. You can be on a green card and work visa and permits and all that. So not everyone who lives in the United States legally is necessarily a citizen by that system. So you can ask, do you have the legal right to remain permanently in the United States? Because it's perfectly okay to be in the United States if you have some kind of visa or something through the legal immigration system. Now, if you're the interviewer and an applicant tells you illegal information, do not pursue the information. Just drop it, drop the topic, do not ask questions. If the applicant says, oh, you know, in the small talk phase, the applicant goes, oh, my week's been great. I picked up my kids from soccer practice yesterday and they were so happy and energetic. Okay, you cannot go, oh, how many kids do you have? How old are they? Okay, no. So they mention kids, just let it go. Don't ask, do not pursue the topic. Do not ask for clarification. Do not volunteer your own information about your kids, because that's all gonna become fodder for a lawsuit if you don't hire this person and this person talks to their lawyer, okay? So just drop it, do not pursue it, let it go. Now, if you're the interviewee and you get asked an illegal question, okay, so here are your options. There isn't one right answer to this. It's just what you think is best in your situation. If you think it's still beneficial for you to answer the question honestly, then go ahead and answer it. I've been in that situation before. I was interviewing at a university and I came to the campus interview and they were showing me housing and they were showing me faculty housing. And one of the ladies, and she was somebody on the committee, she's not an HR person. So these aren't professional interviewers. These are just regular professors conducting interviews. One of the committee members was like, as she was showing me faculty housing, she's like, oh, are you married? Now, I know that that's an illegal question, but I also know that if I'm not married, it's a good thing because then they don't have to worry about spousal relocation and paying for all that. So I went and answered the question, no, I'm not married. Okay? So it was beneficial for me at that time. I made that calculation to go ahead and answer it honestly. But let's say it's not beneficial to you. So they ask you an illegal question and it's not beneficial. What you can do, and what I encourage most people to do, is to answer the spirit of the question without directly answering the physical question. When you answer the spirit of the question, you're kind of answering the concern behind the question without giving any information that would be discriminatory in nature. So if they ask something like, are you religious? Okay. Are you Catholic or something? Okay. Let's just say, are you Catholic? Let's just say this person's like, are you Catholic? Okay. If you think they're asking this because you're not going to work on the weekends, because maybe this job is very weekend based and you have to go to Mass on Saturday and Sunday, you can answer the spirit of the question and say, I can guarantee you that whatever I believe, that I will be available to work on the weekends, if that's your concern. Okay? So just answer the spirit. What do you think their concern is behind that question? And just answer what the concern is behind it without having to say the illegal information. Okay? So what's the why? And just address the why. If they ask you, do you have a disability? Okay? You can just say, I can assure you that I can do all tasks that you give me. I've reviewed the job posting and everything that is listed there, I can do on my own. Okay? So there you go. You don't have to answer the... Because then they should know when you're kind of dodging the physical part of the question, but answering the spirit, they should know that they're up to no good, and then they should back off from there. Your third option, it's my least favorite, but I understand sometimes you have to do it, is you just have to prefer not to answer that at this time. Okay? You don't technically... Interviews, you're not legally required to answer any interview question. So it's not like you're under oath and you're like in an interrogation room with like a low-hanging lamp and you can't leave until you answer all the interview questions. So if you don't want to answer something, don't answer it. Now, you have to remember there's going to be implications to doing this because it's kind of like standoffish, I know. It's kind of confrontational and you may not want to do that because you want to make a good impression on the employer. But at the same time, you don't want to be discriminated against and just say, I prefer not to answer that this time, and then just see if they back off from there. But if not, answer the spirit of the question, and that should get them backed off. And then if they keep pushing on the illegal stuff, though, then talk to an attorney, and that's all I'm going to say from there. Talk to an attorney. Okay. Determine if the following questions are legal or illegal to ask in an interview. Let's assume there's no bona fide qualification. So here's an activity. Is this legal or illegal? Are you available to work on Sundays? Is that legal or illegal? Oh, yes, right. It's legal, okay? Because it's not asking what your religion is. It's just asking, are you available to work on Sundays? Do you have a history of anxiety or depression? Is that legal or illegal? Yes, it's illegal. Very good, very good. It's asking about a disability. What languages do you read or speak fluently? Is that legal or illegal? Oh, that's legal, yes, because it's not asking about citizenship. It's not anything about that. It's just, do you know any other languages? How old are you? Legal or illegal? No bona fide qualifications. That's illegal. That's age discrimination. Don't do it. Don't do it. Now let's talk about closing the interview. So you've asked your great questions. You looked at the resume. You looked at the job posting. You asked biographical questions that weren't illegal. And now it's time to close the interview. So of course, you're going to ask them, do you have any questions for us? After they ask their questions and you answer them well, here are the steps to closing. So you're going to ask for questions. Again, sorry, I got ahead of myself. You ask for questions, okay? So you ask them, do you have any questions for us? Or do you have any questions about the process or what's going to be happening next? If they don't say anything, provide the next steps. So your natural close shouldn't just be, do you have any questions for us? Okay, and then you give your answers, and then pause. Okay, all right, well, that's it. No. So answer their questions. If they don't have any more questions, interviewee will say, I don't have any more questions. Okay, great. Well, here are the next steps for the process. We have two more candidates to interview. We hope to fill this position by the end of the month. So we'll try to give you a call next week, letting you know the next steps in the process. Okay? And then just depending, some employers, like it could be early in the interviews, they might say, we hope to make a decision on who we're going to invite to interview for on campus next week or on site next week. If you don't hear from us by Friday, just assume we're pursuing other candidates. So some employers don't want to send you the rejection letter, so they just say, if you don't hear from us by this date, just move on. Okay, so there is that. And then once you provide the next steps in the hiring process, then just cordially dismiss them. Walk them out of the room, walk them out of the building. Some buildings are really confusing and big and large. And, you know, a lot of times post-interview, you'll learn new information about the person because they're now relaxed because the interview is technically over to them. So then they start to say more stuff. And sometimes you pick up more information that you wouldn't have normally gotten in the regular interview. So walk them out the door, shake their hand, and, you know, just wish them goodbye. Give them your business card if you want to give it to them. And that's the end. That's the end of a job interview. But ask for questions. Give the next steps in the hiring process, and then cordially dismiss them. Don't let them end the interview. You end the interview. You're the interviewer. It's your time. Lastly, in conclusion, think and read critically. Being an interviewer / recruiter is an exercise in critical thinking and BS detecting. So now that you know how to write a resume and a cover letter and all the little tricks and techniques and such that go into it, now you have to be the good consumer who knows how to dissect that stuff and see through it. Give every applicant a way to shine, but that's one of the critical things of interviewing. You, as an interviewer, you want your applicant to be their best. You're not there to destroy the applicant or to humiliate the applicant. You're there to want the applicant to want to work for you. If they end up being your star candidate, you want them to come back. You don't do that by derogating them. You do that by helping them shine and really seeing what they're made of. Avoid legal questions. Lawsuits are expensive, okay? Lawsuits are expensive. And then follow your company's hiring policies. Now, when you go out into the workforce and you're tasked with having to interview people because you're an assistant manager or whatever, your company might already have a list of questions you're supposed to ask. Companies, because of lawsuits, companies are very cautious about the whole interview process. And so some might even say, you don't even get to write the questions. Just use this little thing and stick to them and do not go anywhere else. Okay? So just follow your company's hiring policies. And that's pretty much it. So good luck in conducting your interviews and be a good interviewer.